In this episode of Art Loft, meet your makers featuring Typoe.
Art is in everything. Art is in business, art is in development, art is in music. All day, every day, it's conversations and it's challenging each other. And I think just connecting with other creatives.
Photographer Emily Peacock offers viewers a glimpse into her personal life.
I like the way her work makes me feel when I look at it. So I redid the images from her aperture monograph as self-portraits, and if there was any other character in the photograph, it was my family members.
Inflatable, explorable art from Jimmy Keenly.
When it's not inflated, you can't really tell what's what until you get some air in it. It takes a lot of communication, I'd say. Which is kind of difficult because once it's inflated, you can't really hear what's going on.
And a graffiti mural spells out powerful messages.
Graffiti in general can be traced back to the caves of Lascaux, and there's a long history and tradition of writing on walls. What's so fascinating about the Middle Eastern tradition is that Arabic graffiti is so heavily based in its calligraphic traditions.
It's all ahead in this episode of Art Loft.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by Friends of Art and
in the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show. And every day is another masterpiece.
Hi, I'm Jumaane N’Namdi, and from the studios at South Florida PBS, this is Art Loft. Welcome back. I'm Jumaane N’Namdi. Now this week on Art Loft, we're getting visual. We're covering the country looking for some hot stirrings in the visual arts. Of course, we start right here in South Florida, where the art scene is always hot. The new Tropic joins us with their Meet Your Makers series. Tonight, they take us into the creative process of Miami artist Typoe.
I'm Miami-based artist Stuart Sheldon. Today, we meet a beautiful human and good friend of mine, Typoe. Typoe is one of Miami's freshest artists, and his journey from street art to a multi-disciplined impresario is as fascinating as it is brilliant. I hope you'll enjoy.
I just can't stand still. I don't know how. I want to do like a thing over here, and then I want to do a collaboration with a musician, and then I want to work with a brand, and I want to make shoes. Just do everything, because who knows how long we have. So I might as well just do it now.
Art is in everything. Art is in business, art is in development, art is in music. All day, every day, it's conversations and it's challenging each other. And I think just connecting with other creatives, whether it's in fashion, whether it's in music, whether it's in whatever, and all of us just working together just because, like, yeah. We're all here. You just do it like honestly and just do what you're supposed to do, that's it. Like, I've always been an artist. My mom's an artist. She taught me when I was a baby, and like, she would make me sit in the room and draw perspective, and then she would have me like draw her reading the newspaper, and that's kind of how I got into it. Like, there was never any other option for me. I never wanted to go to school because I didn't want like a safety job. I didn't want to, like, I feel like if these teachers are, you know, reading to me what's in the books, like, why do I pay them to do that? I'll just buy all the books. Earlier in my career, I was best friends with Santiago Rubino. And when we were young, we were always painting on trains, and I would sleep at his house, like under his coffee table with like a pillow, and then we'd wake up at 4 a.m. and go paint trains and run around, and like, we would just be hoodlums, you know?
So you spent almost 10 years represented by arguably Miami's premier gallery, Spinello Projects. How did you come to meet Anthony Spinello?
So I started painting the walls for them, setting up their shows with him. I started taking out his garbage. Like, I was like all the way at the bottom. I was selling furniture, I was painting kids' rooms. I was kind of just like a hustler of all trades. I just put myself around them. The first studio visit he did with me, he came in and he looked at these paintings that I was doing, and he was just like,
this is crap. Like, this isn't even art. And I remember it, I was just like so torn up. And then I went home and I really looked at myself and I was like, is this what I'm gonna be making? No. So I went and I made like a whole series, and from there it was just magic. So I was chopping up the spray can tops and I was doing mosaics with them. And then he came in and he was like, done, you have a show and your first show's in a few months. And then like the next week I had like magazine shoots and we just started going. We showed in Switzerland and Mexico and in New York and LA and all over the place. For that decade span, it was so awesome.
Art is one of the still pure ways that people learn, feel, and thanks to artists like you, interact. One of the things that I think about your work right now that's super important is it's inherently playful. I mean, there are these large play objects.
So I like to think of a lot of things like how we grew up, how we learned as children, like simple things like playing with blocks. You know what I mean? It's sort of a bonding experience between a father and their child, or a child and their friend at school, like how to play well with others, how to utilize space in relationship to your natural environment, how we're building in this environment in the world, construction versus nature and relationships.
So I'm particularly interested in your play environments, this whole like new landscape that you're entering now. Like, tell me about this building playgrounds thing.
When I was a little kid growing up in the Gables, there was this park, Dante Fussell, and this huge sculpture of a person sitting there out of cement. And I remember I used to run up it and roll down it, and that was my favorite part of my childhood, was going to that park and playing on that. And I thought, I love going to like New York or other cities where they have so many public spaces that invite people to be active. I wanna do the public art here. What I wanna build are like sculptures that are functional, that you can work out on and play on and have experiences with. This is something that is a passion of mine that like I can give to other people, which is just get outside and see something and do something, especially in Miami. 10 years ago, it was like, why don't we just get out of here? Because this pond's too small, you know? And then I think we came to a point where we're like, we need to build this pond out. You know, we started all the murals in Wynwood and all of that stuff. Like, we're always trying to put Miami on the map. And that's why we live here, and that's why we're gonna build our new gallery here. Yes, there's part of it that's museums and shows, but then there's the other part of it, of like community. We at Primary saw this kind of hole and we're like, well, we want to bring what we love, you know, we want to show the art that we love, so that we started doing that. And then after that, it was really cool because then I got an understanding of what I wanted too, of excitement, of the level of people working with me and really getting into my work and understanding it. And then now I'm on the other side where I'm helping sort of manage artists' careers and kind of understand who they are and where they want to go and what they want to do. As artists, we're sort of poets. I think we're all just trying to make sense of it and capture it. That's our job. We're documenting history. And not to just read it, but to like feel it. I try to do that with my art, is make people feel something. Whether you hate it, you love it, at least you're feeling something. If you can do that, that's everything, like mission accomplished.
Coming up on Art Loft.
So this is the labyrinth part. So you can wander around, and this will have lots of patterns. Sometimes they'll just stay on, and then they'll be chasing LED patterns. Maybe I'll even leave it completely dark for 2 seconds. And then you'll just wander around and go different places.
Houston, Texas photographer and filmmaker Emily Peacock casts herself and members of her family as subjects in her work. The result is a humorous glimpse in her personal life. Now, this is brought to you by Houston PBS. Check it out.
I made films when I was younger. Me and my neighbors made films. There was always like creating a story, yeah, for sure. When I first started messing around with photography, I was doing a lot of self-portraits. And then I started photographing my family. I think maybe at first they were a little bit like, what? Like, what? What do you want us to do? Why do you want to take that picture? They're so used to it now, so they're just like, what? Okay, where do you want me to go? What do you want me to do? My sister and my mother I probably worked with the most. they're like the most willing to do whatever I ask them. For the Matter of Kinship series that I did with my sister, it was like, I need you to get naked, I'm gonna be naked, and I need you to sit on my back. Like, I'm Atlas holding the world. You know, my sister's like, okay. I feel like through my photography, I've gotten to know my family really well, and they have been so supportive and so awesome. I fell in love with Diane Arbus from an early age, so I knew about her work in undergrad. I like the way her work makes me feel when I look at it. So I redid the images from her aperture monograph as self-portraits, and if there was any other character in the photograph, it was my family members. So it was sort of combining a combination of my work, which was family, and her work combined. And so I was the subject and I was the photographer. So from that series came the Pietà series, because Pietà in Italian means pity. So I felt like my family, to a certain extent, had taken some pity on me. I got them to hold me like Mary is holding Jesus and sort of look down on me and take pity. But unlike the Arbus series, where I'm sort of disguised in each photograph, but with this series, I wanted to make sure that the viewer knew that I was in charge of the photograph, that I was a photographer, that no one else was behind the camera, that it was really just this moment between me and this person who was holding me. I'm very lucky in that sense, because I don't think a lot of people's family would go as far as my family has gone with me in this journey of photography, for sure. My mother passing away made a huge impact on my work, because she was my main collaborator and my main support system, I would say. So since then, I've been working more alone in my studio and more setting up images in my studio. Sometimes I make these little sculptures or make these little still lifes and photograph them. So a lot of the objects are from my childhood, and these are all from my room when I was a kid. And I'm thinking about the future, but sort of looking at objects from the past. You know, I've done photography for so many years and I feel really comfortable with it. And video, it's like now I'm feeling a little bit more comfortable doing a little bit more video. The film August is about a young artist who is going through a family tragedy, but then is just like going about her daily life. So going to a family birthday party, going out to a bar, to work, artist talk and artist opening, and just sort of going about her daily life, but not really being present because her mind is somewhere else with a tragedy that's happening that you don't really know exactly what's happening, but you get a sense that something is. And so she's sort of quiet and silent throughout the film, and it's just these interactions that she sort of has with other people. The first scene in the film, that's shot in my parents' house. Sophie, the actress, is walking out of the room where my mother passed away in. It was shot in all of my family's like homes and backyards. I don't think I had been back to my family's house since my mother had passed away. So it's a very personal film, for sure. Like, what's next for my photography? I don't know, I'm just gonna keep experimenting and keep learning. I want it to be different every time. I don't want people to sort of know what to expect whenever they see my work.
Coming up on Art Loft.
Pascal Zoghbi is the Lebanese artist who is in Beirut, and he is primarily a graphic designer. And Duel is a local graffiti and mural artist. These two artists together were working on this project.
Artist Jimmy Kinley likes to think bigger than the canvas. A giant inflatable called Wiggle, Giggle, Juggle is built to let audience get lost in its walls and perhaps his name and discover how much fun art can be. WVIZ PBS Idea Stream brings us this amazing story.
Yeah, thanks.
It might work.
Unlike most artists, Jimmy Kinley doesn't wait for inspiration to begin working on a new sculpture. It starts with a walk through the museum.
It starts usually visiting the space to walk around, take lots of pictures, where I get floor plans and I make a digital model of the museum. And once I have that to scale 3D model, I can start ideating and doing iterative designs so I can make something fit the actual space.
It's not traditional paint on canvas. It's not traditional carved sculpture. It's the kind of fabric that you would see on a sailboat, a bouncy house. So that is inviting to people. They feel more comfortable with it and they want to engage with it and touch it physically.
After settling on a design, construction begins with scissors, needle and thread, and hundreds of feet of brightly colored cloth.
It's sewn together with a double seam, so it's stitched twice on each seam. It used maybe 800 yards of polyester fabric. It's a 200 denier weight fabric, and it has a urethane coating on it.
I think a lot of contemporary artists are using non-traditional materials to help get through to a new audience.
Jimmy took up sewing while in graduate school, making costumes to go along with his performance art. Soon he was fabricating pieces large enough to fill an entire gallery.
When I was in graduate school, I made a lot of bicycle performances where I'd make a bike and ride the bike around town, and rather than wearing normal street clothes, I would sew a Topic-based suit. If it was a bike that drew pictures, I would use raw canvas. If it was a bike made of Lexan and it was see-through, I would use clear vinyl to make the suit. And as I moved into wanting something that would be lighter weight, I continued sewing and making inflatables.
Keenly's inflatables come to life thanks to a computer chip called an Arduino board that controls air compressors and lights that bring the sculpture to life.
There's nothing wrong with a static, aesthetic object, but a lot of times that's less captivating than something that's kinetic and moving. We move around, we change our location, so I want it to have more anthropomorphic or relatable features. And so if it can have breathing by using an Arduino, which is an open source microcontroller, then I can control the fans, I can control lights, and it can have more of a life than just a static sitting object. We should pull this up now.
Installing these inflatables is no easy task. It takes a small army of volunteers to push and prod them into place.
When it's not inflated, you can't really tell what's what until you get some air in it. It takes a lot of communication, I'd say, which is kind of difficult because once it's inflated, you can't really hear what's going on the other side.
You can work at home and sew the piece, but when you get it to the museum and unfurl it, you have to kind of figure out what goes where. So the first time we installed the work here, Jimmy spent a lot of time kind of configuring it with our staff and laying it out and figuring out what seam was where and where the lights were gonna go. So at one point, Jimmy was actually lost inside of the work and we had to find him. He was so calm about it. You never think of art as being something that you could get lost in.
Not lost on Keenly's art is the one-of-a-kind experience visitors get from engaging with his work.
So this is the labyrinth part. So you can wander around, and this will have lots of patterns. Sometimes they'll just stay on, and then they'll be chasing LED patterns. Maybe I'll even leave it completely dark for 2 seconds. And then you'll just wander around and go different places. I think the two most exciting parts of an inflatable are when it's inflating and going inside it. And it's a logistical nightmare to have people go inside an inflatable. So this is trying to simulate what it's like to be in the inflatable, but you're really on the outside.
The title, Jiggle Wiggle Giggle, it kind of tells you this is how you can act in a museum. Art doesn't have to be super serious. It can be humorous. It can invite you to play. And that's really what we're trying to do here at the museum. We want people to live their lives with a little bit more creative uniqueness, our creativity, and we want them to think about art in a new way, in the way that it fits into their life. So Jimmy's a perfect artist to have here at the museum because I think he helps people break that barrier that might not feel comfortable at the museum because he's such a comfortable guy.
So by having the inflatable surround the audience in the space, it can kind of give them that surreal environment experience. I want people to squeeze in between the piece and the walls because it's kind of squeezing and snaking in between the architecture, so I want you to do the same thing as the piece. It's not meant to take itself so seriously. I mean, I try really hard to make these things. There's plans ahead of time and things are measured out, and it's all there's an idea of how it's going to fit and work in the space. And at the end of the day, it's like, yeah, but we're still just putting a huge blinking balloon in an art museum, and that should be a lot of fun. And so I try to always remember that. And if I'm having fun, then there's a chance that someone else might have fun when they see it.
Next week on Art Loft.
It is really important to make things by hand, really start to finish. I think, you know, meticulously crafting things and really creating the experience and what you hand off to someone is important to me as an artist. I feel like I want to be very involved in every step, or as much as I can be.
The Princey Museum in Houston, Texas has a new paint job, thanks to graffiti artist Duel. The graffiti commissioned by the museum incorporates Arabic and American typographies to promote the museum's latest exhibition. Join us as Houston PBS gives us a look.
As long as I can remember, I've always been a fan of signs, of hand-painted signs. We've been seeing them when I was younger. And then once I got into graffiti, I think that it just opened up my eyes to it even more. I was able to take typography and fonts and enlarge them and use them and bend them and twist them around and create, you know, new letters from those original shapes. So it's definitely a big base of my graffiti and street art.
The mural that's outside was designed specifically to bring together two different artists from two different backgrounds. Pascal Zoghbi is the Lebanese artist who is in Beirut, and he is primarily a graphic designer. And Duel is a local graffiti and mural artist. These two artists together were working on this project as a collaboration.
We've been going back and forth on email to try to come up with kind of a minimal design that would incorporate American and Arabic typographies. So we both decided on one saying, which is the saying of the show, changing language, changing worlds. And he decided to write it in Arabic, and then I came back on top and kind of weaved it together with the American typographies.
Graffiti in general can be traced back to the caves of Lascaux, and there's a long history and tradition of writing on walls. What's so fascinating about the Middle Eastern tradition is that Arabic graffiti is so heavily based in its calligraphic traditions. Pascal Zoghbi wrote in a calligraphic style that's based on the Kufic style, and Duel is responding and translating that message into English.
I kind of wanted the wall to have the feeling of it changing and morphing, so I decided to choose a couple kind of traditional fonts and typographies that we use a lot. So I kind of wanted to stick to the cyan, magenta, and black scheme. And then there'll probably be a little bit of yellow still added in to the end. And Pascal really wanted to go with like more of a real minimal design where we still left a lot of the negative space. So kind of just came up with this design where the letters kind of bounced up and down and kind of gives you a little bit of motion as you look at the wall left and right or vice versa.
The way in which writing is displayed has a great impact on culture and identities. And there's a historical lineage and precedence about why certain styles and fonts have been used and created or suppressed. I wanted that message somehow to be conveyed since we are the printing museum and we have a very long mission that's about preserving and sharing the knowledge of printed communication and art as the greatest contributors to freedom and literacy. just like a wall that we have that was empty outside can often be a barrier. It could also be a means of opening up communication and breaking down walls.
If there's a meaning, it's just the thing that, like, even though we're in different parts of the world, like, and there's different letters and different languages, that you can still say the same thing and have the same meaning or express the same feeling.
Well, thanks for joining us on Art Loft. You can always connect with us on social media at Art Loft SFL and watch us anytime on the PBS app by selecting WPBT2 as your local station. For Art Loft, I'm Jumaane N’Namdi. Now remember, art imitates life, so what? Live a beautiful life. Peace.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by Friends of Art and
in the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show. And every day is another masterpiece.